thank you for being here tonight. Each year, the Mississippi Humanities Council selects a teacher here to present a program on humanities. And if I remember right, our distinguished speaker was supposed to have done this last year, and something happened. The creek rose, the bridge fell in, and so what we did is we just cycled this thing to this year. So what a wonderful day, night, occasion. If you've been keeping up with things today, did we have classes today? We had the Career Expo. We had the Super Talk Radio. We've got the Miss ICC pageant. But one of the very important things that's going on is the Humanities Series, because Dr. Cass Patrick is a lot of fun. And our Dean of Instruction for the college is going to introduce him. And I have described him as the Pied Piper. Any student that has ever had a class or been exposed to Dr. Cass Patrick will follow him into the ocean, because they have such respect for him, for his knowledge, and what an eclectic individual he is. But it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Jen Reed Bunch, who is also a very eclectic person, has a fine arts background, has a stellar reputation, and is a dynamic educational leader, not only at Itawamba Community College, but in the state of Mississippi. Dr. Bunch.
Freshman and sophomore theory, and of course he's the leader of the jazz band, isn't he? Y'all are all smiling. Yes, he is. And he's been an assistant band director, but in the past 9 years, Dr. Patrick has served as division chair for the fine arts department. And so we've worked very closely together for the past nine years, and I must say, the department, the whole division, has grown immensely under his leadership, and the musicality has really increased. It is a fun place to be and a fun place to work at Itawamba Community College when we have such an outstanding fine arts division. I want to tell you a little more about Dr. Patrick. In addition to his teaching, he has remained active as a performer, an arranger, a composer, an adjudicator, and a clinician. He served on numerous occasions as a clinician and adjudicator for various jazz festivals and solo ensemble competitions around the Mid-South. His total number of arrangements, transcripts, and original works now number near 1,000. Some of his writings include works for jazz band, marching band, symphonic band, choir, woodwind choir, brass choir, various show choirs, orchestra, solo classical guitar, and multiple guitar works, various church choirs and orchestras, and church handbell choir. A current project is the transcription of 50-plus Renaissance lute pieces from the 16th century to classical guitar. The set of pieces is to be used for both recital and teaching classical guitar majors. That's impressive. Some of his past honors included being inducted into the Ole Miss Jazz Band Hall of Fame, Phi Kappa Phi, Phi Mu Alpha Professional Music Fraternity. Patrick is also part of the All-American Olympic Band for the 1984 Olympics in Los Angeles. And I recently just found this out, and I want y'all to know he actually has a gold medal from that experience, and he shared that with me. So the things that I learn about Dr. Patrick every day make me more and more respect him every day. In addition to his ICC responsibilities, he does have a life outside of work. He has a lovely family that are with him tonight, and he serves as instrumental director and arranger in his home church of First Baptist in Tupelo. He also serves as one of the adult leaders of Boy Scout Troop 3. He completed the highest level of Boy Scouts of America training, Wood Badge, in 2009. And I remember when he completed that, it was a wonderful day for Dr. Patrick. He was very excited, and I might have seen the little boy in him still. All of his degrees were completed at Ole Miss. Can you believe it? Ole Miss, absolutely. He has a bachelor's in marketing. He has a bachelor's in music and clarinet performance, a master's in music composition, and a doctorate in music theory. The topic of his doctoral essay was 18th century counterpoint, definition of terms and practical exercises. I'm sure something you'd all like to read. The secondary areas for his doctorate were music education and music history. As I mentioned tonight, he's joined by his family, his wife of 23 years, Amy, and their two sons, Ray and Sam. When I speak of Dr. Patrick to Dr. Cole, I always refer to him as the real deal. So tonight, I introduce to you the real deal, Dr. Patrick.
So, I have a new plan, and a new plan is always take just above that plan of action that's required for slacker faculty, and just below noteworthy. That way, nobody gets no one's attention. I don't have to go through any kind of any of this anymore. So, but thank you. It really is an honor to be in a place where people celebrate good things that are good, and people like to do what they do. This is fun. Hope it'll be fun. And we've got a major topic tonight: jazz. Some of y'all know that's what I like to do the most. And topic tonight is, how do you define it? What is it? Where did it come from? Well, good luck with that. Let me crank up the PowerPoint here. And something you're going to find out is, students know that I don't do anything without chalk. Okay? They laughed at me in the bookstore when I asked for chalk. They said, "You need what?" And I said, I'm the last dinosaur standing. So my font tonight is in chalk. So thank you. Took me a while to find it. Now, what is it? How did it get here? How did it get here? If you look in all kinds of dictionaries, if you ask various jazz musicians, you'll never come across the same definition twice. Why? Don't know. I think one of the reasons is that it's such a wide, encompassing field, wide encompassing art, that no two people agree on what it really is. So, here's what I want to do. Let's take a look. It's going to be a long night. I hope to have that here by 10 o'clock. It's one of my favorite military quotes is by George Custer. I have a plan. Now, what is jazz? If I just mention jazz to you, what comes to mind? Anything. This is not a lecture, this is interaction. I don't do it for lectures.
New Orleans.
New Orleans, okay. What else?
Dancing.
Big band.
Big band. And little band, maybe? Combos? It's all right. Oh, sorry. Okay. Now, better? Wow.
It is talking.
Okay. I will do my best. I'm slow, but I am friendly. So what is this? All kinds of things. I thought first I would ask a dictionary. It's always good to go there to define terms. My students know that I like to have clean definitions. That helps things go by so much better. So, here's what the American Heritage Dictionary says. A style of music native to America, characterized by a strong but flexible rhythm, understructured with solo and ensemble improvisation on basic tunes and chord patterns, and, more recently, a highly sophisticated harmonic idiom. Or, it's big band dance music. That helps a whole lot, doesn't it? Okay, we can go home now. That doesn't help at all, does it? It doesn't narrow it down to why is that? If you think about it, there's so many different styles of jazz. There's Dixieland, there's the earlier stuff people call jazz, but it's not ragtime. We'll talk about that later. There's big band, there's bebop, there's school jazz, there's fusion jazz, there's techno jazz. And the unique thing about jazz is once all of these forms started, they never quit. Like Baroque music died out. Medieval music, fortunately, died out. I mean, that was 1,000 years of guys that sang in Latin and dressed together in robes and lived together and did nothing but sing in Latin. That music needed to die out. So, but jazz has held on, I think partly because of the way we communicate now, so much faster. And in the Middle Ages, if you were born in Fulton, you would probably live and spend your entire life and die within 2 miles of where you were born. Nowadays, people change careers, 8 times, I think, is the average now throughout their productive lifespan. 6 or 7 different cities, maybe not even on the same continent. So we move around a lot, and we've all got, I don't have an iPhone, but y'all have iPhones and things where you're constantly in touch with the rest of the universe. News travels fast, so does art. And I think for that reason that there's always somebody out there, I'd like to hear some Dixieland music, there it is. Or I'd like to hear some big band music. There's always a Sirius channel on satellite that has big band. It's out there, so it's encouraging to people to get interested. You can still find it, as in during the classical period, during the Baroque period, during the Romantic period. Once those guys quit playing Romantic style, Baroque style, that was it. New music was in, and you had to be in the presence of musicians to hear it. Jazz was the first art form where you could actually record it. That's a big deal. They were recording operas in 1912, 1910, something like that. The first jazz recording was 1917. Opera was already on it. That was Romantic opera, and it was fortunately, for some people, how you look at it, on the way out. Where you've heard my definition of opera, right? It's a group of people with eating disorders screaming at you in a foreign language. So it just depends. Some people like this stuff, some people don't. That's the reason we have apples and oranges, Baptists, Methodists, whatever. So find your music and dance to it. Now, let's go to another one. So I thought about asking what some great jazz musicians would think about. What's their definition of jazz? Bill Evans, phenomenal jazz piano player, and as close to a jazz philosopher as there'll ever be, probably. And had a good point. Jazz is a mental attitude rather than style. It uses a certain process of the mind expressed spontaneously through some musical instrument. I'm concerned with taming that process. It's a mental attitude. That's different. Well, not that you wouldn't have an attitude playing Mozart or Bach. I mean, there's a mindset there. There's rules there. But it's a little bit different than jazz. Jazz musicians live on a little bit longer leash than classical musicians. They can do more things, and they do more things that aren't on the paper as opposed to what the classical musicians are chained to. Neither is better than the other. They're just different. Next one. Louis Armstrong. Oh, this hurts. This really cleans it up, doesn't it? Look what he said. Hot can be cool. Cool can be hot. Heat can be both. But hot or cool, man, jazz is jazz. Try putting that definition on your test next time and see how well that one flies. It breaks every rule, right? You use the word to describe the word. That's kind of tough to sell. But he's getting that it simply is what it is. It's different from the other kinds of music. They didn't know what else to call it, so they called it jazz. There's also much debate over where the term actually came from. At this point, who cares? We agree that a certain kind of music is jazz, and that's close enough. I really like this one, George Foreman. Who would have thought? Boxing is like jazz. The better it is, the less people appreciate it. You don't think that's true? And I think that's not just jazz. That's just music and arts in the general. Pull up to any red light, and then you hear your keys start rattling in the ashtray. And, you hear some rappers. I heard some this morning. It was 3 cars behind me on Highway 45 as I was trying to get out of Tupelo. And the louder and the rowdier, it seemed like more people like it. That's okay. That's their music. They can dance to it while they still have hearing. That's fine. But he's got a point. At a certain point, jazz, like any other art form, I think what he's trying to say here, requires that the listener bring something to the performance so they get something out of the performance. It'd be like going to a foreign movie with no subtitles. And you stagger in after the opening credits, and you missed all the ads, and you sit down, and they're blathering and some foreign language, and after a while you run out of popcorn, so you just get up and leave. You never know what's going on. So you just, and that's the way some people approach jazz. It seemed so chaotic at certain points that they think, why bother? But there is order to this. It just takes a while to learn to listen to it. Great tenor sax player just passed away, Johnny Griffin. This is a good one. We touched on this briefly this morning in freshman theory. Jazz is music made and for people who have chosen to feel good in spite of conditions. This ties in with Schopenhauer's idea of negating the will, his way to escape the doldrums of everyday life, the absolute depths of disparity, by contemplation through the arts. We're producing the arts. He's got a point there. They've chosen to play something that sounds good, whether they feel good or not. Or they can turn the switch, and they can play a ballad that you wouldn't dare listen to in the dark by yourself, because you would need, you know, Prozac and a Pez dispenser to get through three choruses of it, because it's just kind of depressing sometimes. But the music is fantastic. That's what he's getting at. That feels almost like a sellout, doesn't it? Thelonious Monk. If you don't know who Thelonious Monk was, he was a really great, believe it or not, in spite of his definition here, a great teacher of other jazz musicians. He made them think and rethink what they thought jazz was, and where the harmonies could go, where the melodies could go, how improvisations could and may not always have to fit. And he produced some sounds nobody had dared to, and after a while people began to realize that he was up to something. I don't have a definition of jazz. You're just supposed to know it when you hear it. That helps a lot too, doesn't it? So, These folks aren't too good at defining, even though they're great players, and they did very well. They all left multiple albums and Grammys and things in their way. People still discuss their game. Vic Spiderbeck, great cornet player from the late 20s, early 30s, drank himself to death on illegal prohibition whiskey at age 26, but was the trumpet player in the land. Phenomenal. Cornet didn't play trumpet. Notice close, trumpet players, that's actually a cornet. That's before it was fashionable to play jazz on a trumpet. They thought trumpet kids' toys. Cornets was the way to go. Oops, how did I do that? Okay. One of the things I like about jazz is I don't know what's going to happen next. Do you? Oh boy, that's not good on test day. But when you go to a jazz concert, that's what happens. I know what tunes I'm going to play, have no idea how it's going to turn out. That's the fun part. You get used to not knowing. That's what we like about it. Another guy, Oscar Peterson, we'll see one of his quotes in a minute, said, it's not like a top 40 band. We have to go in and play the same 10 top 40 tunes every night. There's hundreds of jazz standards, and these guys might go weeks without repeating a tune. That's a staggering amount of literature to keep memorized. But that's just what they do. You do it every, you know, six nights a week for 50 years, and you catch on to a few things. There's no substitute for time on the job. Oh, as a teacher, that one's really tough to take. If you have to ask what jazz is, you'll never know. Yikes. What do you get, man? If you're totally clueless about how to play your horn, asking what jazz is meaningless. As simple as some of the jazz things sound, as rudimentary as some of the early Dixieland things sound, this is not beginner music. There's a reason they don't teach kids in the fourth grade to play jazz pieces. It's tough music. It's tough to play technically. It's tough to teach stylistically. That's kind of what he's getting at. You've got to know your horn first, and then you have to have an understanding of the music, and once you can think clearly, remember, Bill Evans said it was an attitude, a mental attitude, then you can approach playing jazz. Different concept. He was on the side. Oh, quick aside, by the way, I heard a review years ago about this man that collected sounds. He was an acoustic engineer and got really interested in sounds that were disappearing from our life that you don't hear anymore. Like, what does it sound like to have a horse-drawn buggy go by you? So he would go out and record these sounds. What does it sound like to be in a water-powered grist mill? What does it sound like to be in a blacksmith shop? And he would record these sounds. He cataloged thousands of sounds, different kinds of, you know, if you ever watch the old Yankee Workshop, okay, it's probably not. They all kinds of strange hand tools and things, and they all made different kinds of noises. And he recorded those noises. And then he started recording people's voices. And he recorded several thousand, just, I guess for lack of a better term, industrial sounds and voices. And believe it or not, of all the voices and all the sounds that he recorded, about a 1,000 question or survey, I guess you would call it that. And each sound snippet was about 2 seconds long. And he would sit there and just write down as quickly as he could what was sound bite number 4. He'd play 3, and he'd play what was 3, what was 5, what was 6. The most recognizable sound of everything he had recorded. And these are not just people from the United States. This was an international survey, pool of about 15,000 people. The most recognizable sound in our society today was the sound of Louis Armstrong's voice.
Wow.
That's pretty good, especially from us. A public school system that says you're going to have 12 years of English and 1 semester of a fine art, but yet they recognize Louis Armstrong. Interesting, huh? There's some power there, isn't it? All right, now, oops, I'm spoiling the surprise. So far, we haven't been able to plainly define it and nail it down. But bless their hearts. In the South, you can say that in front of anything before you just really tear somebody up. Bless their hearts. The people in Washington figured out, we don't know what it is either, but they did do something good about it. 1987, they actually passed a resolution. It was started in the House, passed the House, passed the Senate, that confirmed jazz as a national treasure. There it is. It has something really neat buried in this. Look at number one. Jazz makes evident to the world an outstanding artistic model of individual expression and democratic cooperation within the creative process. If there ever was such a thing as an acoustic equivalency of democracy, it's a jazz combo. There's no one directing. There's no one guiding traffic. There's no one. It's a self-governing body. Each person knows what they're supposed to do and what they're not supposed to do. Kind of an interesting concept. So, they actually got one right, so give them credit. So, all right. Now, describing it. Defining it didn't work. Describing it may be a little bit better. Duke Ellington, great piano player, great band director, band leader, and some consider probably the most prolific composer of all time. There's some debate there, but he penned over 2,500 works. That's a lot, especially when it was all done with a manual word processor. Okay? In his BC, and there were no computers when he was doing this. So, here's what he says. By and large, jazz has always been like the kind of man you wouldn't want your daughter to associate with. It hasn't always been the highest regards of people. Jazz musicians have always been suspect. In academia, musicians and the fine arts have always been sort of off on an island from the rest of the campus. Okay? When they came along and created jazz, they built a raft and pushed off. And as a result, it would be in the early to mid-70s before jazz would actually be offered in something other than a jazz band setting. You can now actually get degrees, a bachelor's in jazz education, a master's in jazz performance, jazz education, and a doctorate in jazz performance and jazz education. And a couple of places where you can begin to offer jazz degrees in jazz history. Kind of interesting for something that 100 years ago was looked at as good people don't play that kind of music. Yeah, they do too. It just took a while for the reputation of the music to get there. Oscar Peterson. I love this quote. Okay? What he said. Some people try to get very philosophical and cerebral about what they're trying to say with jazz. You don't need any prologue. You just play. If you have something to say of any worth, people will listen to you. It's really neat to go listen and watch the marching band. Well, you know, 600 or 700 people, it seems, take the field, and it's just a wash of sound and colors, and you go to center stage, and it's the same way. It's just constant. It's really kind of neat, and it's great. But the thing that really appeals to me with jazz is this. You just go out, you sit down, and you play. It's real sparse. There's a sparseness to it that has always appealed to me. Al Hirschfeld is a name you may not know. He was a cartoonist that would do caricatures. I don't know how you're supposed to say it, but it was, he would take a single line and do a side profile of someone, and he would do it with one line. And he used a flexible tip pen, so if you used a lot of pressure, you get a wide mark. Very light pressure, you get a thin mark. But he would do these pictures of people with one continuous line and would never lift the pen. And I heard him in an interview, and he made a statement, said, I've always been impressed with what you can do with one line on a piece of paper. Turn that into, what can you do with one musical instrument on a backdrop of silence and an empty stage, same concept. Two or three musicians is all you need. Sometimes a solo piano is all you need for a solo guitar player. The sparseness really is appealing, okay? You don't have 47 people playing the same part. You've got one to a part, and they're all different. Ooh. One of my heroes, Woody Herman. Some guys dig ditches, I have a band, that's what I do. He's just trying to justify what he did for a living. But still, they're not doing a very good job of describing it. So, now we're down to, maybe we can figure out how to recognize. For those of you that have served time, excuse me, have taken music appreciation class, we talk about the four fundamentals of a tone, okay? The four characteristics of a tone. And they're pretty simple. And this is in all music. It doesn't matter whether it's opera, jazz, top 40, bottom 40. It doesn't matter. Even the stuff, I call it red light music, stuff you hear when you pull up to the red lights and hear somebody beside you playing their music, even that has all four characteristics of a tone. They're kind of skewed towards one of them, but that's okay. That's their music. You can cast a look through it. But pitch. This refers to the high or low of a sound. Music is made up of a whole range of pitches. Okay? Timbre. Oh, that's a good one. That's, timbre is a way an instrument sounds. A clarinet sounds different from a piano. Hopefully. A trumpet sounds different from a trombone. Okay? It's your ability when someone calls you on the phone, hello, a couple words. You know who it is by the way they sound, because their vocal timbre is irrecognizable. That's what that is. Okay? Rhythm. What is rhythm? It's varying durations of sounds and silences. Nothing complicated about that. And volume. It's got to be loud enough to hear it. But even within that, there are changes in volume, right? A lot of y'all are musicians, so forte, mezzo piano, pianissimo, all kinds of changes in volume above audible make the music listenable and more interesting. That's all wrapped together. So jazz is no different. It has those, but those are elements. Which, when you put elements together, how many is in chemistry? Okay, you put elements together, what do you get? How many times have you been in chemistry? Compounds, right?
Yeah.
Compounds of jazz. Melody. But Mozart wrote melodies too, right? Jazz is no different. But what is a melody? It's a succession of single pitches that have varying durations of rhythm. So we're combining some of the elements to make something different. Harmony. This is where it gets to be kind of fun. I'll have to put the mic down to explain some things. Chord progressions. What in the world is a chord progression? Jazz tunes are based on chord progressions that repeat over and over. And a chord progression is this. It's a collection of sounds that are close together that follow one another. And they can lead you through a phrase. In music, there's two elements. Two elements only. There's tension and resolution. That's it. That's all you have to work with. And those musicians that can put the tension and the resolutions in the right place are the ones that create music that is listenable. When you get those mixed up is when you get the emphasis on the wrong syllable, and it's kind of difficult to understand. Get the idea? So let me give you an idea. Chord progression. I'll put this down for a second. I was just to play. We'll drag it to tune in a minute called Summertime. It has every four beats. At your foot, every four beats, the harmony changes. Starts on D minor. To G. Even to D minor again. Every four bars it changes. And here's another one. So it kind of pulls you through, right? If I was just to do this. You got to hear the last chord, right? Again, that's that tension and resolution setting up. Now, what do jazz musicians do? They take these simple tracks. We haven't talked much about origins yet, but I'll skip ahead and we'll catch up to it later. A lot of the jazz we play is built on what came out of the Delta about 125 years ago, the blues. And for the most part, it was fairly simple harmonically. Triads, three-note chords. Thank you. jazz musicians at this time thought, there's more I can do with this. So what they would do, they would take bits and pieces of the melody and wedge them into the chord so it all was kind of wrapped in together. So instead of this nice, clean 12-bar blues feel, fortunately, that's, I mean, we might as well go back to Gregorian chant from the Renaissance, from the medieval period, right? And just sing it, you know, have our blues pieces be sung in Latin and be done with it, you know, we've come full circle. And the last thing I kind of alluded to already, substitutions. What this means is this, jazz musicians don't just improvise new melodies, what they also do is figure out new ways to force feed more chords into the progression. I don't say they have attention deficit disorder, but it's pretty close. They can't stay on one thing very long before they have to do something else. Four beats on one chord, that's forever to a jazz musician, especially a rhythm section player. So what they will do, here's our 12-bar blues. 4-2 beat, right? Okay, after a while, that'll get on anybody's nerves. So what I'll do now, I can see the fretboard, is kind of typical what jazz musicians would do. Instead of four beats per chord, it's one beat per chord now, but I'm still keeping the chord progression flow, and it's still 12-bar blues. Those that play rhythm instruments do, when they will watch guitar players and piano players ruthlessly to steal their tricks. Quick side note, if you watch any early clips of Louis Armstrong, he always had a handkerchief, okay? Always hot under the lights, but that was the second reason for carrying the handkerchief. He knew that some of these really other really good trumpet players would stagger in after they finished their jobs and knew he'd be playing someplace else, and they were sitting in the front row just staring, watching. They were watching his fingerings. They were stealing his licks because they were good enough trumpet players they could associate sounds with fingerings. They were figuring out how he was doing some of that stuff. So as a result, he would play with his handkerchief over his fingers and stare at them. Now I'm copying. Yeah, you know, I kind of like that approach, you know. So make it work. He had to work for it, so y'all work for it too. So, yeah. Now, let's see, where were we? Where did it go? A few of the compounds. Ooh. Summon jazz up into something I think that makes it recognizable. Swing, not rhythm. But the basic idea in jazz is that it swings. What does that mean? I'll use this. If I was to play a melody, well, summertime. To it whatsoever. Let me show you how bad it can get. If nothing else, I can be a good example. Tonight's kind of unique for me because it seems most of the time when I was going through high school and college, most of the time I was asked to be somewhere, the people that I had to answer to would start their question with, what in the world were you thinking? Now I'd say, oh, would you share something with us? So this is a nice change for me. Let's go back to summertime. First, I'm going to play the melody absolutely straight. No swing feel whatsoever. Like this. or a group that doesn't like to dance, because that's really going to squelch that feeling altogether. So now what happens if I go back? That's different. If I have two notes in the beat, the first one seems to have a little more weight to it than the second. Long, short, loud, quiet, right? Short, quiet, loud. They're not even anymore, are they? Ooh, try that in the orchestra sometime. You'll be looking for a new job. They don't appreciate that kind of interpretation, okay? Don't do it in class piano either. Mr. Myers loves jazz, but not in class piano. So now, let's try this again. Get a little more volume. Where you don't expect it. Jazz is full of it. And if you don't put syncopations in, it can get kind of dull. Okay? Let me get rid of this one. Let me show you this real quick. There's a tune called Have You Met Miss Jones? Kind of a tough tune. But the melody is written on the lead sheet in very square rhythm. So much of jazz has to do with
concert,
not following
B flat tuning note.
Thank you, I'm a fan. But now,
maybe.
First of all. Seems so square. Watch what happens if I can get the band in the box today.
Thank you.
So, all right, counterpoint. Ooh, I wrote a paper on this one, but I'll condense it to about 30 seconds. Counterpoint is a type of music where the voices are rhythmically different. We've all sung hymns in church where we have sing the same words with the same rhythms at the same time, but maybe different pitches, depending on which church you go to. I'll play just a real clean example. This is not jazz, it's Bach, but the good point here is this. There's a melody. And the bass line. And those two together are different rhythms, but you play them at the same time. So it's long notes on the bottom against quickly moving notes on the top. That's counterpoint. The voices are rhythmically different. Kind of get the idea. Jazz musicians do the same thing. Improvisation with the right track. And what it was this. What collective improvisation was, is each instrumentalist played their own version of the melody at the same time. So all of them wrapped together kind of made it sound. So the result was with the clarinet, trombone and trumpet, those three, plus maybe a banjo and usually a walk-around tuba player, you got the effect of all the chords. Very lightweight music, but not so easy to do. So what I'm going to do, this is an early Louis Armstrong piece called Chop Suey Walk. Where they get the name from, I'm not really sure. But what you want to listen for, the cornet Louis Armstrong plays, and the listen close in the background, the clarinet and the trombone have different rhythms all the time. That's the counterpoint we're talking about. They're all sort of making up their own version of the melody. Softest instruments being the closest and the loudest being the furthest away. And that's the way they edited it. If you made a mistake, you took the wax master off, you watered it up, you put a new one on. There was no editing. One take. So you get some old recordings that have some obvious flaws in them, but the feeling was right, so they let it go. But a good example of early counterpoint. Now, we've got a couple other things that were almost done, believe it or not. Ooh, expression. Expression is not unique to jazz. Every art form in music and visual arts has expression as a backbone. Okay? But one of the things that's unique about jazz is it's an oral tradition. Most of what jazz players do is not and has not been written down. So how do they learn it? Some people would go listen to the musicians play live. Like the guys would watch Louis Armstrong and hope he took his handkerchief away to steal a few licks from him. They had to go to where the musicians were to hear and copy what they heard. And then, if you're lucky, you could buy a 78 double play album. It had about 3.5 minutes of music on one side, 3.5 on the other. Scratchy, gritty, but it was recorded music, and you could play that over and over until you learned to play along on your instrument with them. A lot of jazz musicians would do that. Bix Beiderbecke would make a recording, and that record would sell out. All these cornet players would take it home, put it on their Victrolas, and just play it till they wore the groove out of it. So they learned to sound like Bix Beiderbecke. There wasn't a book on how to do this. There's a lot of books out now, and quite honestly, a bunch of them full of garbage. Ears are your best teacher. But this is sort of a unique tradition. Very few people learn how to play the Bach preludes by ear. But jazz musicians, you know, people, especially classical musicians, look down their nose at playing by ear. That's actually how we do this. And I can speak as a classical guitar player. Once you learn the music, you play it by ear anyway. That simple. We just go through a different process to get it stuck in our minds so that that is the way we can remember it. Articulation. Jazz musicians don't always have the nicest, cleanest sounds that you would expect. A lot of them had, you know, bachelor's and advanced degrees in all types of substance abuse, which didn't lend itself readily to good breath support and air supply and things like that. So they didn't have the best sounds. Also, coupled with the old recordings, they sounded scratchy and wheezy anyway. But some of the older guys lived into the 50s and 60s, and you can hear them play, and they were sometimes kind of raunchy sounds. But the emotion was there. It wasn't in the perfect tone, it was in the perfect delivery. Okay? Articulation. It's the way you start and end notes. I can tongue everything really quick, or the vibrato is even considered an articulation. So if you did that in a Mozart symphony, man, you would be yanked so quick. But in a combo, not only is it expected, it's encouraged. And a little hiss in your sound, that's okay. Miss Cobra would not like the way I play clarinet when I play jazz, because it's just not that nice, pure, pristine clarinet sound. There's a time and place for everything. And especially when a clarinet is having to cut through a full jazz band or a combo where they're just rattling the, you know, the dust out of the attic, you gotta have some cutting power, and you don't get that with a really pure sound. You gotta have a little edge to it so that it cuts through. And these old guys knew that. So they didn't have the best sounds in the world, but they could, 50 yards, they could cut glass. As a matter of fact, Louis Armstrong wrote in his book, talking about some of the jazz musicians in and around New Orleans, and talking about the way they would attract music. Clientele was, they would, if you've been to the French Quarter, there's a sidewalk, and above the sidewalk is a covered walkway on the second floor. And a lot of times the band would be out there. And they were used to attract the customers into the not-so-nice places, you know, called Storyville. And he talked about one trumpet player had a great range. And usually when trumpet players say range, they talk about how high he can play and how low he can play. And he said, no, his range was measured in miles. You could hear him from 3 or 4 miles away. So he could really attract the customers. So, and again, it was probably not the prettiest sound in the world. If you ever get a chance, I tried to bring in a picture, but couldn't get one down. But Louis Armstrong actually took his first cornet where the mouthpiece was permanently attached, and cut grooves all the way around the mouthpiece to assist his embouchure. I have no idea what he was trying to assist. He didn't have the greatest sound, but you had to admit the guy had range, so maybe that's what he was after. He actually shallowed the cup so the higher notes were a little easier. Interpretation of melody. One more quick one here. There is a jazz piano player that all other jazz musicians swear up and down, this is the guy, Art Tatum. He was born blind, or legally blind. He could see color. He could see light and dark, but he couldn't see shapes. There's very, very, very few videos of him playing. What's striking about it is that when he played, he sat motionless except for his arms. He was all over the piano. Phenomenal technique. He was one of the few people that would buy these classical albums. They were 78s, excuse me. He bought these 78s that had all the complete collection of Bach preludes and the Chopin preludes and the Chopin etudes and things like that. He learned to play all that stuff by ear by the time he was a teenager. By ear. But here's his recording of a tune you'll hear a lot next week at the football game called Tiger Rag. It actually was a Dixieland song to begin with. And this goes by several different titles. Several different names. But it's been recorded as probably the single fastest piano improvisation on record. This was recorded around 1929, 1930, I'm not sure on the dates. It's Tiger Rag, and it's just him. And what's unique is this. Not only did he play jazz, he also understood classical music very well. And Art Tatum was the first to begin to wrap in classical music and jazz together. And during a performance, which is almost unheard of in early jazz, he would change tempos. He would change styles. And the whole time, both hands were just all over the place. The guy was a phenomenal technician, but he also was very musical. So let me drag it up, and we'll close out with Tiger Rag here. And then if you're dying for questions, I'll be glad to hang around for that. A lot of piano players have just taken that album and just snapped it over their knee. The guy was a phenomenal musician. That's just the tip of the iceberg. A couple of quick things. The nice thing about jazz, I think that my next slide is the last. We'll skip a few things. Here we go. Nice thing about jazz is, ignore that. It's nice to be in a situation where there's more than one possible right answer. You go to algebra class, there's one right answer. You go to DNA and you carve the frog, where's the heart? There's one right answer. You go to American history, when was the Declaration of Independence signed? There's usually one pretty good answer that they're looking for. And you start getting creative, and they might appreciate the creativity, but it still adds up to an F. But in jazz, it's a little bit different. We're presented with problems that have multiple possible solutions. And the good thing about it is this. There's no wrong way to do it. Some notes sound better than others, but you can do it the way you want. Okay? So what is it? What is jazz? It's music that has a swing element. We discovered that. I think we agree. And it has some elements of improvisation. Some have more, some have less. Some pieces have no improvisation at all, but sound very jazz-like. And I'm okay calling it jazz. Some pieces are totally spontaneously improvised. That's okay too. That's still jazz. It swings. So the definitions are unique. And each, fortunately, we are all different. Okay? because it'd be a dull existence if we all liked the same music. And what, you know, we think it has to be some variety. We have nothing else out there to explore. So the unique thing about jazz is you really do can find a place for your individual voice. And that's what you begin to look for. It's not that you want to play Mozart's 40th Symphony just like the Boston Pops did, but you're going to play Tiger Rag. And if you can play it like Art Tatum, there's not a university in the country wouldn't give you a doctorate in piano performance right now. But there's probably only a handful of people in the world can do that. But you can't find your own voice trying to sound like Art Tatum, or like Oscar Peterson, or Bill Evans, or Louis Armstrong. And that's the fun part. There's no wrong answers. It's just how far are you willing to pursue finding your own voice. And to me, that's what jazz is all about. A very unique form of expression. Any questions? Comments? Gripes, whines, criticisms. Well, again, I would like to tell you, Dr. Cole, this has been an absolute honor. I appreciate that you letting me do this. And it's also nice to be in a place where I can do this. And there's not a single part of my job I don't enjoy. And I get to talk to a lot of these folks daily about what jazz is and how do you do it and how it's been done. And this is fun. So thank you.
Well, you know, let's give him a hand. I come to the realization a long time ago, and I want to just say this to you, that we've all had the privilege to sit at the feet of a genius and listen to him talk about something that is a passion of his life. And can you imagine the amount of brain cells that he has to be able to play all the instruments, know the background, intimately, multi-layered, compounded of all forms of music, and then have the gift to be able to teach that to others. So as soon as the rest of the world finds out about Dr. Cass Patrick, it will be our loss. But in the meantime, we will try to keep him under wraps, okay? Thank you, Doctor.